current state senator and, well, future congressman, Pat Fallon, is with us. Morning, sir. How you doing?
Good morning, Mark. You are a great American.
I try, man. Hey, I thought about you on the day that... Tell everybody how this goes. John Ratcliffe leaves the 4th District of Congress to go be Trump's Director of National Intelligence, and it's not like we have time for a primary. So what are the nuts and bolts of when local Republican Party leaders gathered to find somebody to make the nominee for an election that's 70-some days away?
It was a bizarre and unique process. There were 154 precinct chairs from the GOP and county chairs across 18 counties in Congressional District 4 that assembled on August 8th for a congressional convention. So the campaign was about 90 days long. And, Mark, it was bizarre. We would have forums where we'd have 22 candidates and only 8 people that could vote for them. It was like a junior high dance. We would just be sitting there waiting to talk to them. Sometimes there were lines waiting to talk to the voters. And it was very untraditional in the sense that you could literally get to know, and I tried to. I met in person with 147 of the 154 delegates. It was a really neat deal, because now you've got so many really close friends that can help you, be a better congressman, be a better member of Congress, because they're spread out over those 18 counties.
To say the least. What made you decide to enter that fray in the first place?
Honestly, to be very candid, we've got to stop sending the B team to D.C. I mean, we need people that are proven known entities that will fight for our conservative values and virtues and principles and fight fiercely for them. I mean, you've seen the left turn off a left turn off the left turn that the Democratic Party has taken. They are now literally proudly saying that they're socialists. And, AOC and the New Green Deal and all these things, we've got to expose them. And then the myths, like the Black Lives Matter is based on myths. No data proves or even shows. In fact, the data shows, when you look at it, that African-American folks are less likely to be harmed by police than Caucasians. But they don't want to talk about that. So I want to live within basis of reality, but get on the national stage and fight not only for President Trump's priorities, but against these myths.
When we take a look at what lies ahead for you, it's an incredibly short. People run for Congress. People are going to start running for Congress usually the day after the prior election day, because it's 2 years, it's forever. This has telescoped down. You're instantly thrust into that. And so what's it like raising money? What's it like planning a campaign? As if that's not weird anyway in a virus. So just tell us about the path forward to November 3rd for you as you try to become a congressman.
Yeah, because everything switches. I mean, I was laser focused on 153 people and did absolutely no fundraising because you didn't need it. I think I spent in the neighborhood of $25,000 to get a congressional nomination, whereas, that's usually $1.5 million kind of adventure now. So now it's the traditional campaign where we have to raise money, get out signs, talk to the media, go to events. I was just in Texarkana last night. The night before, I was in Gilmer. It's 18 counties, so it's a large, very large district. And we've got to get the word out, because we also have to run up the score in CD4 to offset the votes that will be coming out, the net votes for Democrats in Houston and Dallas and Austin. And by the way, Mark, I was in Austin 2 days ago. It is like a war zone.
Man.
And it looks like Austin lost. It's disgusting.
I know. And there was Governor Abbott in Fort Worth yesterday talking about, all right, listen, any community that's going to defund the police, maybe we freeze your property taxes so you can't raid, one pocket to finance another and engage in that kind of activism. It's funny. It is the John Ratcliffe departure from District 4 that creates this entire dominoes thing. The last time I was in a room with you, I was in a room with him. Remember February 1st? It seems like 10 years ago. It was the Grayson County Republican event. It was a joy to be up there. He was there. You were there. IMC, the thing. We were having a great time. Man, who knew what lay ahead?
No, yeah, there's just no possible way you can know these things. Listen, if we're movement conservatives, I mean, Ted Cruz endorsed me and came up on the day of the vote because he's a movement conservative. So we're always going to be looking for our best and highest use. And many times that's in God's hands, and it's about timing, and this just fell into place. And, it was kind of interesting. One of the other main candidates that was running for this decided he was going to focus on fundraising. And I'm thinking, what does that matter? I mean, if you don't win, what are you going to do with the money? So he was successfully raised $100,000, and I successfully got 82 votes to his 34. So he's got, I don't have any money, but he's got the 100 grand, but yeah, so, I'm the nominee.
That's, you know, that's so. A surprise. Nothing succeeds like success. So let's, okay, this is not really suspenseful. I know you take nothing for granted. No one ever should. And we need to get out there and give Pat the massive landslide that he needs. We need to make sure President Trump wins comfortably. We got to make sure John Cornyn wins comfortably, because we can't have this purple Texas mythology hanging over our head. You got to be thinking about, you know, being sworn in and what your thought is. What does Congressman Pat Fallon's agenda and checklist look like?
Well, number one, we have to start talking about a balanced budget amendment again. And that almost, you know, was kicked out to the states, and I think it was the late 90s. And so that boulder had made it almost to the top of the mountain and then roll all the way back down. We've got to start pushing that back up. A merit-based immigration. These are issues, by the way, Mark, that win the middle. We can be very conservative. We don't have to become more moderate. I think that's the path to disaster. But why not have a merit-based immigration system? We've got wonderful people all over the world that want to come here. Let's take the best the world has to offer. Obviously, we want to repeal Obamacare, repeal and replace it. I love the idea of a flat tax. We need desperately congressional term limits, and have workfare where people, you know, what a disaster it's been with the welfare, and it's been generational, and it hasn't succeeded, and it's not helping anybody, and it's in fact hurting the country. But you know, people, we need to have these discussions. And you know, Ken Paxton told me once that it's more important to kill bad legislation than it is to pass good legislation. And I completely and fully agree with that. Because, oh, another thing though, how about defunding sanctuary cities at the federal level? If you don't want to comply with federal law, and I thought we were supposed to be a rule of law nation, then we withhold federal funding from you, because you're being literally lawless and you're making your citizens unsafe. Zero-based budgeting would be something that we've got a handle on our spending. You know that D.C. doesn't have a revenue problem, it has a spending problem.
Yeah, exactly right, which is what takes me back, because I'm fascinated that the first thing you mentioned was a balanced budget amendment, which has always been a good idea. But what, you know what it has in common with term limits? Everybody seems to think it's a good idea, and yet it never passes. And I always kind of wonder why. A balanced budget amendment would require constitutionally a balanced budget every year. And sometimes people say, you know, there are two ways to do that. One is to cut spending, which is good. That'll balance your budget. But the other one is to raise taxes to the moon. Do we run a risk with a balanced budget amendment of a Democrat Congress saying, hey, we got to balance the budget. We're the Democrats. Time to raise taxes.
Well, they can do that formula, and then they're going to get voted out. Remember 2010 when I think Pelosi lost 63 seats? That was a glorious election cycle. If that's their path, then they're going to be in a minority party for decades to come. Because one thing I noticed, well, I'll give you a perfect example, Mark. Remember, we had Proposition 4. I was the author of that and carried it in the Senate. And what Proposition 4 did on the ballot was, for those listening, was it made sure that we essentially banned the possibility of a state income tax in Texas in our lifetimes. And we needed 19 Democrats to vote for that. Every Republican in the House and Senate voted for it. But me and Jeff Leach, Representative Jeff Leach, pulled off a legislative miracle, and we got on the dime 19 Democrats to vote with us. But then we kick it out to the citizens, and everybody voted. And I think we got almost 80%, which meant it passed with even Democrats. Because Democrats, some of them, many of them, don't mind you and me paying more in taxes, but they sure as heck don't want to pay more in taxes. And it's a formula for disaster if the Democrats at the federal level want to continue to raise taxes.
The Pat Fallon path has been an interesting one, and I've known him for virtually all of this, from Frisco City Council to the State House to the State Senate to, God willing, and voters showing up and doing what they need to do, to the Congress of the United States. And Pat, in a little over a decade, nice going.
Well, thank you. It's been a wonderful journey. And you know what, though? You know, what are we all looking for, Mark? We're looking for people that will do what they say they're going to do, whether it's on a city council or all the way up to the presidency. And that's why President Trump has resonated so strongly with conservatives. Is he said, like, for instance, he said that we are going to move the American embassy to Jerusalem in Israel.
And did it.
Now, Republican presidents. Yeah, thank you. Republican and Democratic presidents have said it in the past, and they haven't done it. He did it.
Yep.
And the media went, I can't believe you're doing this. He said, yeah, but that's what I said I was going to do. That's all we've done. And the Frisco City Council, when we killed the Arthur Collin County, it was going to be a boondoggle, spend $80 million so people could have subsidized performances of Madame Butterfly. And, you know, that I took political hits for doing it, but it was the right thing to do. And then when I ran for the state house, we got over 70% of the vote against a Joe Strauss lackey who spent a pile of money. And then, as you know, when we ran against sitting senator that had been serving for 17 years and spent $1.5 million, we beat him by 40 percentage points. Why? Because I do what I say I'm going to do, and that's what we're all looking for.
Well, look forward to, if there's any help we can give you on the campaign trail, we are here, and look forward to some conversations with you from Capitol Hill in the beginning of the second Trump term. That's just a fun sentence to say, Pat, and congratulations to you. Oh, I'm sorry, I've neglected. Got any thought about who your successor should be, shouldn't be, what level of involvement you'll have with that, or is that just rearview mirror at this point?
No, not at all. I absolutely love Senate District 30. I mean, we have 14 counties, 105 cities, 111 school districts, 45 chambers of commerce, and I was a member of all of them at one point, and that was not cheap. But it's great folks. And so I'm going to reserve judgment. Obviously, there's big names that are out there. I think you had Ms. Luther on, and Representative Chairman Drew Springer from Cook County is seriously looking at it, and I served with Drew since 2013. I want to learn more, and I'll have an open mind, but I have a vote in this. So what my thoughts are is to have two or three candidate forums in areas around the Senate District 30, make sure they're very fair and substantive. And then, you know, because campaigning is about vetting and see who is the proven conservative.
So you're going to serve. Well, I should have asked this 3 minutes earlier. I wouldn't give anything back, but you're going to sort of steward over MC, arrange some candidate forums that essentially say, hey, I'm the outgoing guy, but I want to provide these forums for people interested in being my successor to get out and make their case.
I love the district too much. I mean, there's almost 1 million people, and it's one of the most Republican and conservative districts in the state. I think it is the most conservative. And so let's talk about their legislative priorities and their plan for constituent services and any innovative ideas they have to hold the office. And then, you know, you can put it on Facebook Live, and we can leverage social media to do that. Invite, I don't know, there might be others that jump in the fray. But let's get the most informed citizenry will make the best choice.
Is there and I don't know if people are sitting there drumming their fingers on the table, since what's going to happen to you is pretty obvious and obviously good. Is there an obligation for you to go ahead and step out of that seat? Legislature's not meeting. Is there a schedule for that? Or what's your thought on leaving this seat for the one you're about to occupy?
Yes, there's no doubt. I mean, listen, I'm about to fill a vacancy, God willing, in November. That has been open for 4 months and is going to be open for another four. So Congressional District 4, 760,000 people have been without a U.S. congressman for, it'll be a total of 8 months. And that's, I mean, I understand why that happened, but I do not want to see that happen in Senate District 30. So we can work it. So they're not without a senator for a few hours. And so we're working with the governor's office and the lieutenant governor's office right now on a timeline to ensure that the day that I do resign, there's a successor elected and ready to go immediately. Because we have a great staff. We have 9 folks on staff that do wonderful constituent services. And even though we're not in session, we're constantly – it's a full-time job, as you may imagine.
Yeah, it is. And a final thing, because I don't know if this ingratiates her to you, if you're going to be running emceeing a series of forums. But Shelley, about whom many good things can be said, indicated flat out yesterday that she thinks you're sticking around for pension-related reasons. Want to address that?
All right. Yeah, that is not – at all the case, and I don't know why she. I think she's new and green. That was just something that was just completely false and not wise and smart to say. I'm already vested in the pension. We get paid, by the way, $600 a month. I tell my wife it's 60,000 pennies because it makes it sound like it's more. But no, that's not the case at all. That couldn't be further from the truth. What we're working on is you've got a November 3rd election. We're the main goal here is to ensure that there is somebody seated in Senate District 30 in the Senate the entire time. And you can do that. It's a question of when I submit my resignation letter, when it will be effective, when the governor can call an emergency election. And then you always got the possibility, Mark, of a runoff election as well, if it's not just a heads-up race between Chairman Drew Springer and Luther. It could be others, and then if nobody gets 50%, then it goes on, you know, like that. So we just want to make sure. I can guarantee you this: there's not going to be a gap where there's no senator. Because if I wait until January 5th, I think we'll get sworn in Congress. It could be a gap of 3 or 4 months, and we do not want that.
Gotcha. All righty. It is Pat Fallon, state senator now, soon to be member of Congress. Everybody crossing our fingers and putting our noses to the grindstone. We'll talk early and often. Pat, thank you very much. Appreciate it.